What is up? It is Jamie James once again with another vlog for Geartalk. As you can see, I'm representing Geartalk here, and I am here in Benchmark Studios in Nashville, Tennessee. And on today's gear spot, we have the amazing soul Philcox-Littlefield, who is one of Nashville's top guitarists.
Still alive.
Still alive, who is alive and kicking, and he is a massive gear nut. He is a really big gear nut. He loves his gear. So, Sol, can you tell us a little bit about yourself, where you're from, and how did you start getting to play guitar?
Sure. I'm from England. I grew up in Norfolk County, and I moved to Nashville when I was 18 in 2008. So I've been here 11 years and played on the road and did the artist gig thing for a while, and now I kind of transitioned to being a full-time studio player and get to work in awesome places like Legendary Benchmark and lots of other places in Berry Hill and on Music Row. I do a lot of work out of my house, some a lot of overdubbing and some production work, and yeah, pretty much a little bit anything anyone wants to pay me for, I'm usually cool to do it. So.
And you like to carry good gear around everywhere.
Yeah, that's kind of the fun of it. It's like it gives me something to look forward to. If I make each session different and try to curate what sounds I like to use and which certain producers like certain amp setups and certain sounds, it keeps things fresh.
So yeah, that's Sol, everyone. So Sol, let's talk about your guitars. Is there any guitars that you usually bring with you to every session or stuff that you...
Yeah, I would say it's pretty much everything you see here. On master sessions, I'll have my cartage guy will bring more stuff like just the stuff that I don't usually use a lot, like a B-Bender Telecaster, like a Rickenbacker 12-string, and different Les Paul options. But this is kind of pretty much everything. The SG and the Tele have been the current favorites, and then this Gretsch recently that I got has been killer as well. I think it's a 2009 Country Club Special Edition.
Yeah, can you run us through your guitars and what year they are?
Yeah. 76 SG, I bought this online on Reverb from Black Book Guitars in Portland, which is a guitar shop that I love and adore, and I've gotten a lot of stuff from. It's 76, all completely stock. I made an offer on Reverb and it showed up and it just came right out of the box, perfect and already set up, and I haven't touched it since I got it. I've had this for about 6 months or so, and it's been on pretty much every song I've recorded in that time. Got a 69 ES355 that was converted at some point to hardtail bridge and had some electronic work done on it. That's been a favorite. And then I got a 72-73 Tele. I forget the year, but this was another one that was a lowball offer that I made on Reverb that was, and the guitar just showed up perfect, and it just was amazing. So I've just been using that. Stock down electric baritone, these are killer. These run for about $450, and they're really, really good, cheap alternatives to the Jerry Jones custom models, and sound great. Revelator, Eric at Revelator built me that Strat. They do fantastic work. It's the only custom guitar I've ever ordered in my life, and I always wanted a Black Strat with all the wear. They do some really, really unique work with the relicking jobs using rainwater and real human sweat and stuff like that to give it the vibe.
And that's the Beer Never Broke My Heart guitar, right?
Yeah, that's what I used on that. And a lot of other stuff. I think it's Lawler pickups that are in there. I pretty much just told him just to make me a roughly 60 spec Strat with whatever he thought would be good on it. I didn't give him any particulars about pickup selection or anything. I was just like, you're the expert, just build me something that you think is going to be awesome, and it has been. That's about 2 years I've had that. That's been on pretty much everything as well.
Can you tell us about the amps you're using, Sol?
Yeah, it's a 65 Bassman, pretty much stock. I had it worked on and got some new old stock tubes put in it, and that's pretty much it. No mods or anything. It's a really early Reinhardt model. The Titan is one of the first ones. JT Kornfloss uses that same amp. That's been sort of in and out of the rotation for
last seven, eight years or so. That does the Angus Young thing really well if you jump the channels, and it's pretty much there. I don't switch out a lot of amps on a session. It's more just sort of find the sound that works right and go with it, because a lot of the different cue controls and just depending on what pre and what desk they're running in the studio, it's just sometimes certain things work. It's like I pretty much amp wise I don't change anything. Like I'll just pretty much set it and forget it, and just get any of the actual tonal variations will come from the pedal board and
great
guitars.
And what cab are you running?
A Matchless 212 with a Celestian Gold and a Celestian Cream back in it.
And there's another cab. There's another head that you actually have, which is like a DC-30, right?
I've got an HC-30. Yeah, matchless. It's not the one that matches the cab. It's just another one that I picked up in a trade. That's in my cartage rig. That's in my big, all the heaviest amps. Like I've got a Bandmaster that's been converted to a dual Showman, so it's 80 watts. It's got extra tubes and a really huge transformer. That and the Matchless are just heavy, so they stay in my rolling rack. That's got the front and back lid that come off. Like that's what I'll bring along to master sessions, and then anything like this or like my Princeton or little Vibrochamp, I'll just throw in the car in the passenger seat and keep it at home and bring it along to sessions depending on what I need.
Great. And to your pedals, you see we've got quite a collection of pedals over here.
Yeah, this is pretty much the setup I've had for 5 years. I haven't really changed anything out much. I have just I'd carry just a few extra stuff in a bag, like a wah and like the whammy and stuff if I need it. Just it doesn't stay in the chain all the time. Yeah, this is pretty much the basic setup I've had for every thing that I've done. As far as drive, yeah, there's a few other drive pedals and stuff, but
how did you get started on using this whole like Echoplex style stuff into your amps?
Man, this all happened, but when I actually originally first got the full tone tube tape Echo because Rob McNally and Justin Ostrander, two of the best session guys in town, guys that I've looked up to and gotten to spend a little bit of time around and work on some projects together, they both used this, and I was first impressed so much just how good the preamp section of it sounded, like how much it added a real harmonic high-end richness to it. Rob McNally's guitar sound was just always just sounded so rich and real present without being bright and piercing at all, and it's, I figured out that this was part of the sound, and he always runs one of these, and then obviously Justin Ostrander, a buddy of mine, does the same thing. So I eventually was able to source one used. I didn't pay the full price for it because these are kind of running pretty expensive now because they're discontinued. Picked up that one, and I just got so attached to the preamp section in it that I just started using it on everything, even home overdubs. I always make sure I have it with me. Then I started getting intrigued about the other versions. This is the Full Tone's more recent version. It's kind of based on the EP3, like the 70s Echoplex, and it's solid state, no tubes. But same deal, it's got an amazing front end preamp section that just, it's not quite the same as the tube Echo, but it's, it adds something. It adds a really, really cool just fatness to the sound. Like it's like a night and day difference when it's in the chain. And tape echoes are kind of my new thing. I'm kind of been geeking out on them a lot lately, so I've been doing a lot of scouring the internet and trying to find, there's a lot of oddball ones from the 70s too, like these Univox and a couple of, like Tysco and stuff, like made some of these sort of more cheaper versions back in the day, and I've just kind of come to learn that they all have their own thing, and they all have different quirks and different sounds, and I've never been a collector of gear. I always use everything that I own, and but the tape echo thing is sort of the first thing where I'm like, actually, I'm gonna kind of create a collection here and make it my thing, just because I'm really really into them right now.
And that's
awesome. They're just fun, you know. I like things that have moving parts, and it's cool to be able to grab a tape head and physically move it around and change parameters and stuff like that on the fly.
That's so cool.
Yeah, and it's cool. But actually, today is actually the day where I'm actually going to finally go over to
XacToneSolutions or XTC Solutions over in Berry Hill, and they're actually going to make me a proper designated studio board where they're going to build everything themselves, and they're going to run a grounding transformer and an auxiliary send and return so I can patch in pedals if I want to, and they're going to basically, it's going to be the same setup but a little bit bigger, a couple inches more on the width and the depth, so that I can fit in an expression pedal for one of these H9s, fit in a couple more drive pedals that I like to use, so I don't have to just, you know, keep pulling stuff off and unplugging it when I want to use a different sound. That's real exciting because they do amazing work, and I've wanted one of their boards for a long time, and they've very kindly agreed to rush it through so that it'll be done at the end of tomorrow, because tomorrow's my only day off this week, and I'm very anxious about not having a pedal board for even a short period of time, because it's very important. But yeah, we're actually going to go, me and Jem are going to go over and say hi to Barry and the guys.
We're going
to
go to XCS and say hi and see how they're going to build this pedal board. Long neck eyes come here, never broke my heart. Like diamond rings and football teams have torn this boy apart. Like a neon dream, it just don't know me. The bars in this guitar. And long neck eyes come here, never broke my heart. I'm here at XacToneSolutions here in Nashville, Tennessee, and I'm joined with Eric from XTS.
Howdy.
Here. Eric, can you tell me a little bit about XTS and how it all got started?
Yeah. So our boss, Greg, who started the company, started in about 06 or 5, I guess, and he was making pedals, modding pedals for people. Started all the ones over here, so we make all this line of pedals as well. Opened this shop in 2011 with Barry, the other guy there. Doing some rig work here in town. It's our custom shop. I came on board 5 years ago, maybe.
Cool.
So we do all kinds of, we make a line of pedals, kind of anything guitar effects related you can imagine. We can kind of do, Barry's got his master's in electrical engineering, so he can
Pedals and stuff like that.
He can kind of do anything you could want.
Awesome. And do you guys do like pedalboard setups and rig creations?
We call it system integration because we'll take whatever you want, make it all work together. Just a lot of stuff. A lot of our clientele is touring people and studio people, so it kind of has to work in very real-world demanding situations, I guess. So we try to build things as sturdy as we can so that everything's going to break, but we want to push that breakage out as far into the future as we can.
That's awesome. So, where can people find about XTS, and how can people contact you?
Yeah, we've got our website, XacToneSolutions.com. All of our contact stuff's on there. We post a lot of our stuff on Instagram, which is just XacToneSolutions.
Awesome.
Yeah.
And anyone can contact you guys, whether you're not a touring musician or anything?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Sweet.
We'll work for anybody that wants us to.
Cool. That's XTS, guys.
Geartalk.